并且参与一些区块链的建设项目。那2019年曾经参与出版 Libra 一种金融创新实验，并且在年底也出版了19年的年底出版了专著《企业炼金术：区块链法律应用指南》。那个，我们本次研讨会的主题是区块链与智能合约在商业法律中的应用。随着科技的发展，我们说，A、B、C、D，就是我们说 A 是 AI，人工智能；B 就是 blockchain，区块链；C 是我们说 cloud，就是云；D 是 data，是大数据。A、B、C、D 的发展已经催生了数字经济，我们新的数字世界已经到来。那我们知道参加本次研讨会的大部分是法律专业人士，所以我们这些法律人士有没有考虑过法律行业在数字世界的未来？我们的合同形式，那技术人士可以认为 code is the law，那简单便捷，但是我们法律人士可能会说 code is the law 吗？在数字世界，code 和 law 的关系已经变得非常微妙。同时，我们的争议解决形式呢，会有怎么样的改变？我们说改变是肯定的，但是我们怎么样去迎接这个改变，甚至去创造这个改变呢？这就是我们本次研讨会的一个初衷，希望引起大家的思考和参与。那今天非常有幸，可以与 JERA 公司共同举办这个研讨会。JERA 是一家成立于瑞士的法律科技公司。公司主要创始成员就是我们接下来会见到的，CEO Alessandro Palombo，还有 CTO Luca Daniel，还有 CLO Raphael Badaghini 三位先生。自成立以来，JERA 是利用区块链的底层算法，致力于使每一个人在任何的地方都可以获得100%的线上快捷、低成本、全透明的、更加高效，并且有法律效力的一个司法正义。那我们在今天的研讨会中，我先为大家简单介绍一下我们几个主讲人的一个背景情况。首先是JERA 的 CEO Alessandro Palombo 先生，他在过去的3年中，在全球范围内进行过多次的演讲和发言。Alessandro 先生还被任命为圣马力诺共和国生态发展和整合部科学委员会的负责人，最近还被任命为牛津大学深度科学争议解决实验室的顾问委员。Luca Daniel 先生是 JERA 的 CTO，他数十年深耕新兴科技，目前是负责 JERA 区块链法律生态系统的所有的技术和运营。那 Luca 先生目前是生活在印度的硅谷巴加罗尔。在这里，他是组建了一个网络的服务机构，为很多初创企业中建立了一个稳定的这个生态关系。我们说 JERA 的 CLO 就是 Raffaele Battaghini 先生，他是一个意大利的一位意大利的职业律师，是 Battaghini di Sabato 的 law firm 的创始人。为中小企业和初创企业的创新、国际化、区块链的技术，还有并购公司业务以及合同方面提供一些法律服务。同时，他还是全球律师运动组织 Legal Hacker 意大利分部的组织者之一。还有一位演讲者是Luigi Catizani 先生，是 JERA 的法律工程师。他是国际贸易法律硕士，意大利的职业律师，也是 Battaghini di Sabato Law Firm 的律师。鲁伊基先生为初创公司和中小企业，提供商公司的业务和商务合同方面的法律服务，并且对区块链相关的创新和国际仲裁均有深入的研究。作为一名年轻律师，正是这样的兴趣和经历，使他成为了 JERA 的一员。今天呢，Raphael Battaghini 先生会作为第一位演讲者，为大家介绍智能合约，为大家介绍智能法律合同的一个基本原理，包括智能法律合同的定义来源以及实际可行的方案。接着会由Luigi Cantisani 先生 为大家讲述从传统的争议解决到线上争议解决的数字化进程，以及区块链技术能够为此带来的优势和便利。Alexandro 和 Luca 先生会在之后带来关于法律科技领域具体实用业务相关的一个演讲。那接下来我们就最后会由我跟大家一起分享中国法律科技的一些发展状况。那接下来我们就欢迎 Rafael Battaglini 先生带给我们的主题演讲 Smart Legal Contracts。 Hello Hello Rafael, Mr. Rafael.
Hello, hello Jane.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Thank you everybody for being here today. So shall I start with my presentation? Okay, apparently I cannot share my screen. In the meantime, that this technical issue is resolved, I can start discussing. So my presentation is about the smart legal contracts. And of course, this start with what a smart contract is, actually, before discussing what a smart legal contract is. In order to do so, we need first of all to point out that smart contract is not something that was born with blockchain. Smart contract was theorized in 1994. Nick Szabo, who was a computer scientist and also a legal scholar, theorized the smart contract. Apparently, I finally have the possibility. Yes, just give me a sec, please. Okay. So you are seeing now my presentation. So in 1994, Nick Szabo suggested a first definition of smart contract, which was: a smart contract is a computerized transaction protocol that executes the terms of a contract. So basically, smart contract is a software that executes the terms of a contract. And the purpose of doing so was to lowering fraud loss, arbitration, and enforcement costs. Then in 1995, Nick Szabo suggested a new definition of smart contract, according to which smart contract is a set of promises and it's smarter than the paper-based version of the same set of promises. And he also pointed out correctly that no use of artificial intelligence was implied. So smart contract is a software. Yeah, it executes the terms of a contract. It includes a set of promises. And finally, in 1996, Nick Szabo suggested a third version of this definition, which was: a smart contract is a set of promises specified in digital form. Interesting enough, this smart contract approach didn't have a very wide resonance. We had to wait until 2014, when the Ethereum blockchain and the Ethereum white paper were divulged to the public. And then was the time where the term smart contract was appreciated by a wider range of people, because the inventor of Ethereum is the first blockchain that was created especially for smart contract, meaning computer software that executes the terms of a contract was adopted. Actually, we should talk about a decentralized smart contract, meaning a smart contract deployed on the blockchain. But since the Ethereum blockchain became so utilized by a large amount of people, when we now use the word smart contract, we are implicitly saying that it is a smart contract on a blockchain. And if you look at the legal definitions of smart contract available in nations such as Delaware, Tennessee, or Malta, Italy, smart contract is always linked to distributed ledger technology, to blockchain. So today we can actually say that a smart contract is a smart contract only if it's deployed on a blockchain. And what you see here is the actual appearance of a smart contract. So it's a text written with a programming language, for example, Ethereum and VeChain, that is a Chinese blockchain where Jur is developed, adopted the so-called Solidity programming language. So in a nutshell, a smart contract is an event-driven software that provides an output. Event-driven because a smart contract requires a triggering event in order to start working, to start functioning. And this triggering event might be an information that is present on the blockchain, or might be an information that is available outside a blockchain. In this case, we need someone or something that takes this information outside the blockchain and send this information to the smart contract. This source of information is called Oracle. Oracle are the source of information from off-chain to smart contracts on-chain. And oracles might be a human person, a legal entity like a bank, a website like an index or the stock exchange, or might be a hardware like a sensor. You can imagine a GPS sensor may provide an information concerning the position of an object, such as a container. After giving this theoretical explanation, I would like to move to a more practical approach with the FISI case study. FISI was a project from AXA, which is a multinational insurance company, launched in 2017 and ended at the end of 2019. It was an insurance policy on flight delays and cancellation, managed by a smart contract. So basically, you had to go to the FISI.AXA website. You concluded a traditional online insurance contract, but behind it, there was a smart contract. A smart contract that in the 2017 version was quite simple, let's say, because it was comprised by 221 lines of code. And actually, you can check the code by searching it on the Ethereum blockchain, and you will be able to click on this presentation later on to check on blockchain the actual code of this smart contract. The insured event was only the 2-hour delay of flight, and very specific data were stored on the smart contract. The flight details, the limit time of arrival, the premium paid, the indemnity to be paid, and product ID, meaning the typology of contract. The interesting part here is that the source of this information, the oracle, in this very case, was AXA itself. So many people criticized this approach from AXA because they believed it was only, marketing approach, with no actual trust involved in this. But in 2019, a new version of this smart contract was deployed. And it was a much more complicated smart contract, because if the first version, as I mentioned before, was made of 221 lines, the new version was more than 750 lines. The reason of this is that, first of all, the insured event was not only the 2-hour delay, but also the cancellation of the flight. The data collected were the same, meaning the flight details, light, limit time of arrival, premium paid, indemnity, and product ID. But in this case, there were two very important features added. First of all, was that there was an external oracle, a third-party oracle, which is Flight Stats. That is a website that monitor the flights all over the world. So in this case, it was no longer AXA, the oracle, providing the crucial information concerning the status of the flight, but was a third-party provider. And secondly, that payments in Ether were possible. Ether is the cryptocurrency of the Ethereum blockchain. And in the second version of the Fizi contract, Fizi smart contract, it was possible for the user, for the client, for the customer to pay in Ether and to receive payments in Ether, all of which was automatically managed by the smart contract. Also, in this case, you can check the actual smart contract and each transaction managed by this smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain at the link provided. Of course, you should feel free to go deeper on this case study, and you will find specific links to several articles and also a podcast to go deeper in this case study. It is important to state again that this project was shut down in December 2019. In my personal opinion, this was a very interesting use case. It is the reason why I wanted to present it to you today, because it is the it is an example of how a multinational company, insurance company, approached this very new technology. They started with a first step, with a simple, let's say, simple enough smart contract with no external oracle. And then they did a very important step forward with a much more longer, much more complicated smart contract with an external oracle and payment in cryptocurrency. I can assure you that this is not as simple as said for a huge company. So I actually appreciated how AXA decided to step in into the blockchain realm, the smart contract realm, and I actually hope they will start a new project, a new improved version of the Fizi smart contract. So thank you for attending to my presentation. I hope this shed some light on what a smart contract is and how a smart contract can be utilized in an actual practical way for a very traditional contract like an insurance contract, so that you can understand how the smart contract can actually impact the legal world, and how we can move from a smart contract to a smart legal contract, where a smart legal contract might be, or where the smart contract is a tool to automate obligations drafted, provided for under a contract, a traditional contract or smart legal contract, may also mean total substitution of the traditional contract with a text written in computer code and traditional language. I want to stress this. When you will be able to check the code of the physical contract, you will see that information are not written only in computer code, but also in traditional language. In order to explain to non-developers what's the actual meaning of the computer code deployed on the blockchain. So thank you very much again, and I am available for any questions you might have. Okay. Federico, Jane, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rafael. So if anyone have questions, you can ask now. Or, you know, if you have question later, we will have the Q&A section after all the speeches. Okay, anyone has question? No? Okay. If no, then let's invite Luigi Catizani to have a speech, dispute resolution and the blockchain. Okay.
Hey, can you hear me? Good morning, everybody. Okay, it's a pleasure to be here to talk about online dispute resolution. And thanks Raffaele for your clear explanation that will also help me to explain a few concepts. So let me share my presentation. Okay, here we go. I hope that you can see it.
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. So let's move on. The topic that I'm going to discuss is precisely online dispute resolution, meant as a way for, on the one hand, improving access to justice, and on the other hand, also evolving it, like making possible things that were not previously possible. Okay, so I assume that most of you are familiar with the notion of alternative dispute resolution. So methods for resolving disputes different from national litigation, methods such as mediation, conciliation, arbitration, usually in the European continent, arbitration is not included in the large group of ADR. In the US, they use ADR as a way to include arbitration, but you know, this difference about terminology are not so relevant for the purpose of this explanation. The idea is that everything that is different from national litigation can be considered ADR, okay? So most of you are familiar with these tools, I assume, and probably you, in your life, you have chosen mediation sometimes to avoid going before a court. And why? Because litigation can be expensive, it can be super time consuming, and the parties may not be happy at the end of the day because there's a winner, there's a loser, but they both spend a lot of time, efforts, energy, and there will be a disappointed party. Last but not least, you still need to enforce your decision, you know, the judgment made by the court. And so other costs, other waste of time, other energies, and this is very, you know, demanding. Yes, also converting into an effective result a settlement agreement made by mediation or an arbitral award made by arbitration can be difficult. Yes, for sure. But the idea of ODR is covering different needs, okay? Like, depending on my need, depending on my transaction, I can choose the most appropriate tool. And sometimes the tool that way for resolving my disputes is not national litigation, litigation before domestic courts. And if that's the underlying concept, like using different dispute resolution methods for covering different needs, it's easy to explain why and how ODR, so online dispute resolution, came to light. Basically, ODR is just a branch of ADR, okay? And it basically answered to this question, to this issue. I love this quote by Franz Kafka. You know, love should be accessible at everyone at any time. Like, ODR is a way to making things way more accessible and also available at any time, like quicker. And this became really, really true in the light of internet, e-commerce, online transactions, you know, by 90s and on, we had a lot of online transactions, making business become quicker in a way, and also different, okay, because agreements were concluded in a different way, like the way people make small, medium, a large transaction kind of changed. And this required new tools for resolving disputes. I believe that you are familiar with the idea of IDR in practice, even if maybe while using it, you didn't realize that you were actually dealing with an ODR system, because you can find ODR system embedded in platforms such as eBay, Amazon, or even Airbnb, as far as I can see. Like, the way they manage claim, answer to client customers' needs, that is an ODR system in some way, okay? Now, as far as I can see, there is a bit of confusion sometimes about what an ODR exactly is. And so I personally try to get to classify them. But before getting there, I just want to remind this. We strongly believe that the problem, okay, that ODR are trying to solve nowadays is going beyond the scope of e-commerce, okay? If e-commerce online transactions were just the basis for the rise of ODR, now the idea is going farther. It's like improving access and provide for more cost-effective ways for resolving disputes. And why online? Even for disputes that are not based on transaction that are made online. So why going beyond the scope of e-commerce, online platforms, online transactions? Well, because actually, according to an OECD report, the 46% of human beings live under the protection of the law, while more than the 50% of human beings are active internet users. That means that nowadays, internet is way more accessible than courts, tribunals, or other ADR system. So if internet is way more accessible, it thinks that internet can be the pathway, the gate for entering a large justice system. And so here we go with this tentative classification. There are online features, okay? In my view, these are not let's say, complete ODR system, because having online features is just taking a part of a dispute resolution method and using internet technology to streamline it. And so I don't know if in China you have functions like this, but for instance, in Italy, you can file certain requests online, okay? There are, and I will show you one just in a few seconds, arbitration chamber that allows you to file a request for arbitration online. There are in certain country specific domestic, so even domestic procedures that allow you to deposit the file case online. You see, this is just a way for implementing to a limited extent online features, online technology. So it's not a complete ODR system. On the other hand, we have procedures based on an imitative or transformative approach that try to replicate a procedure and try to move it online, like entirely. And so we have electronic arbitration, electronic mediation, electronic negotiation, and so on and so forth. So basically electronic ADR, EADR, let's say. Obviously, all the experiments that you made with online features, electronic ADR, can be, let's say, used to improve also litigation before domestic courts. And that's where we talk about online courts, you know. As I said, in Italy, it's possible, even for national litigation, so litigation before domestic courts, have certain phases of the procedure managed online, like depositing the file case for certain kind of claims or depositing certain requests, stuff like that. So you see how experimenting online in different dispute resolution methods can also help domestic litigation. Like what you experiment there can be implemented in the other large group of dispute resolution method. So, and the last part that I would like to mention is the so-called automated ODR. So these are fully online procedure. But the idea here is that internet technology is used to provide automation. So this is how we link to what Raffaele was explaining, okay, regarding blockchain, smart contract. Well, actually, blockchain and smart contract is not the only way to provide automation. Basically, everything that implements algorithms meant to automate part of the procedure can be considered a sort of automation. But for sure, blockchain and smart contracts provide for a large use of automation. And I will show you how in a few seconds. Let's start with a few examples, okay? This is an example of online, what is just an online feature. So it's not an entire procedure online, but a phase of it, a phase of this procedure is managed online. This is the platform of the LCIA, which you probably know since is the most famous and important arbitral institution in UK, based in UK, actually based in London. And they provided this platform for filing requests for arbitration online. And so this is, let's say, the page where you can file a new request. When you click on file new, you can choose between option A, which says file by uploading documents. So basically you can upload your own request for arbitration. So something that you have written on your own, or option two, file with standard electronic form. So you can go through an electronic form designed by, provided by the platform itself. You can file it and you have your request for arbitration filed online. You see, this is an example of the user interface. This is where you enter the claimant's details and then you move on to the to section B where you file, where you enter, sorry, respondent's details and then arbitration agreement and so on and so forth. Everything that is required under the LCIA rules to have a complete and admissible request for arbitration. So this is interesting in my view. And even if it's not a fully online procedure, it's still something, you know, you make way more accessible and easier, at least the introduction phase of the arbitral proceedings. And also the electronic form can serve as a guideline because if you think of it, it exactly tells you what you need to be doing to have a complete request. So this is also helps. And now I would like to show you a fully online procedure. It's something that we developed at Azure. So for me, it's the easiest way to explain, to talk about an ODR because it's something that we are really familiar with. This is the Azure Beta platform, okay, which uses smart contracts to secure your contracts, your transactions, and also provide a quick and basically a quick dispute resolution way at almost no cost, okay? And the people that you're seeing there are, well, obviously Luca by the Azure team, who was assisting two members of the Azure community, Stefan and Daniela, which performed, okay, a purchase of a car. One was the seller, the other one was the buyer, on our platform, on the Azure Beta platform. And I'm pretty sure that Federico can share the whole story by means of the chat. Anyways, how does this platform work? Well, basically the parties, so the buyer and the seller landed on the platform. They obviously created their wallet. They enter these details, so the details of the electronic wallets of both parties, name, eventually the email. And then by means of this user interface, they set up their contractual relationship. Actually, they had a traditional contract, okay? So this is also interesting because this is how you can connect traditional contract relationship based on paper contracts to online system. They had a written paper-based contract and they moved the details on the platform. So they started to fill in the KPI session. They indicated a sort of proof of performance. They set up the duration of the contractual relationship. And then, and this is the most relevant part when we deal with automation, they deposited the consideration in escrow, okay? So yeah, this shows you how they filled in all the details. This is where they set up the contract value. And the value was expressed in Azure tokens because this is a blockchain-based platform where you need to convert your sum in tokens and you need tokens to interact with the platform. And after that, okay, as I said, they completed, they deposited the sum in escrow and they used the intra-platform system for acceptance of the offer to lock the price. This is where automation comes into play because the Azure Beta platform provides for a way, for a tool for resolving disputes. It's a crowd-based system. In other words, it's a system where the community, so people that use the platform and have Azure tokens can participate and vote, like imagine of the ancient Greece, okay, where people participated in the forum and decided the outcome of the dispute. This is what you can do. And because you have a smart contract that serves as an escrow and it's connected to the online dispute resolution method, the decision made by voters, by the decision makers, by the community members that vote, becomes the source of information for the smart contract. You remember when Raffaele talked about the source of information, the oracles? Well, that online dispute resolution method, so basically the decision made by the voting members of the community, becomes your information, becomes the output, okay, that serves as an input for the smart, the escrow smart contract and allows for the allocation of the sum. So depending on what was the outcome of the dispute, the sum is automatically allocated to one of the party or also split, okay, depending on, you know, the proposals, because this system basically works like sort of baseball arbitration. Party A says, I believe that the sum should be split in this way. Party B says, I believe that the sum should be split in the other way. And so the voters decide which is the best proposal. I mean, the proposal that sounds fair according to how the case evolved, according to how the contractual relationship evolved. And then the voters decide, you know, one of this, which is the winning proposal. And depending on the winning proposal, the sum is allocated to the winning party. So this shows you how a wall procedure can be managed online. This shows you how automation can come into place. And in this case, it comes into place because first, it regulates the interactions online between parties and decision makers. Second, it provides for an automated allocation of the disputed sum, which removes one of the most problematic things in online dispute in dispute resolution in general, which is the allocation of the sum, which is the execution of the decision. On this platform and on other online dispute platform, not necessarily based on blockchain, okay, think of CyberSettle, which was maybe the first successful ODR system entirely based on algorithms, even if it didn't use smart contracts or blockchain. I suggest you to Google it. You know, what this platform do is removing the need for going before a court and say, hey, I need my decision enforced. You don't need it because the system automatically, this system automatically moves your sum, automatically serves the purpose of your, let's say, dispute, of your claim. And so, yeah, these are just other few screenshots that shows you how the platform branch. You see, this is where you choose success or dispute. If you're not pleased with how the contract has been performed, you start a dispute. And this is the user interface to show you how voters are currently, members of the community are currently voting the two proposals that I mentioned, proposal A and proposal B. That's the percentage of the vote. And the system is very transparent, so you can check all users that have voted here. They are listed according to the number of their electronic wallets. You can also read the message that they leave. So basically the arguments that they provided to sustain their arguments, to motivate their decision, how they voted. And so this also gives you a good understanding of who is an engaged and serious voter and who is not. And eventually, but this is another topic, maybe understanding how the relationship between decision makers vote, but it's just to give you an understanding, okay, of the platform. And then yes, when the duration of the dispute has expired, you have the final result, okay? So in this case, it's more than 51% for this proposal, the proposal made by John Carpenter. Obviously, it's a pseudonymous. And then the sum is allocated to the winning party according to the outcome of this voting system. So just to conclude, smart contracts and blockchain, I mean, ODR in general can be a way to automate and provide more accessibility and in some case, lowering costs. Okay, blockchain and smart contracts allow to do something more, like implement algorithms to automate, set up platforms where community can decide. They can be used to, obviously, since they're based on blockchain, this means also a more secured environment and information, you know, are recorded on blockchain, they're immutable, all the technicalities of blockchain. But as you can see, they also provide for a way for creating new ODR, since the example that you've seen so far is not the imitation of another dispute resolution mechanism. It's something completely new. Yes, it's inspired by systems such as baseball arbitration and other stuff, but per se, it's something totally new. But this technology can also be used to replicate existing ADR. So I believe that these are really versatile tools. I hope that the explanation was clear. And if you have more questions, feel free to contact me and Walt, your team. And now it's time for a QA, I assume. Or if you have questions right now, or we can talk later when every speaker has presented.
Okay, Luigi, do you see the questions from Raymond Xu?
Where is the question? I like the Jura system.
Question and answer.
Okay, yeah, I'm reading it.
Okay.
Answer. I like the Jura DR system. I think the key for the success is the Jura token, which will serve as the consideration payment medium to settle dispute. Could the system also accept other cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, USDT, or other currencies issued by other platform? As far as I know, since all these details are under development, and I'm sure that Luca can give you more details, but the idea is that the Jura token represents, we have different cryptocurrencies because they represent different value. The Jura token actually represents the value of this ecosystem. And it's not just a payment token. So you see, Bitcoin is just a payment token. The token is made for making payments. The Jura token is a bit different because it's not just payment, it's also utility. You basically use it as a tool, as a electronic pass for performing other actions, which you cannot see in this better version of the platform, but I can give you a few examples. Let's say it can be used to, for instance, set up an arbitration hub, since the platform is evolving and is actually trying to implement also proper arbitral chambers, online arbitral chambers. It can be used basically as a pass for other interactions between the players engaged in the ecosystem. So it's not just made for payment. So can you use other cryptocurrencies or other kind of currencies? My answer is directly, not really. But the idea is that you can convert the other currencies that you have. And if your answer is there will be a sort of automated exchange so that I can perform my actions with other currencies and then the conversions into your token is automatically performed? Well, this is a technicality that I will not spoil right now. If Luca wants to share more about this, he can, for sure. But it is that at the end of the day, you are using the JUR token, okay? Even if you convert, regardless if the conversion is automated or not, you're still relying on JUR tokens. I see another question, which is in the chat system. May I ask how much and how long time one ODR procedure takes? I guess that this depends on the ODR system that you are using. Like for me, I've used the system of Amazon a few times and it took just a few days. And as regards the JUR Beta platform, the example that I show you is like based on 7 days duration, 7 days duration. So it really depends, but usually they're meant to be quick.
Okay, if no more questions, let's continue. Thank you, Luigi.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's have Alexandro Palombo. Will speak about blockchain and justice, JUR's use case.
Hello, everyone. I'm trying to also share my video. It's really, a great occasion today to, be with you. Thank you, Fan, for organizing it. I am trying to, share my screen also, but it's, okay, let me see. Okay, I'm not able to start the video, but we can fix this problem fairly along the way. So I'm starting my presentation, which will touch with you actually, guys. Okay, now I can share my video. And 3, 2, 1, here we are. Hello, everyone. So I'm Alessandro Palombo, the CEO and co-founder of JUR. In my talk, I would like to wrap up some key elements that both Rafael and Luigi took. My idea with you for today is mainly to give you a kind of step back and to be able to look at the blockchain and legal field from a wider perspective, to try to come together to some conclusions. First of all, before we start, just to, as a recap of what we said so far, what are smart contracts? You know already, they are code that runs on decentralized networks. Smart legal contracts are essentially smart contracts that can be considered also according to the law of a specific jurisdiction. Legal contracts, therefore, they are legally binding and they can be enforced. And then ADR, of course, stands for alternative dispute resolution. Let's start with a broader question. Why blockchain and legal? Why this vertical? Let me try to expand the presentation. Probably you can see now that better, okay. I was saying, why blockchain and legal? This is a major question. Let's try to wrap up our conclusions in two fields. First of all, on the let's say the typical legal activity field also of lawyers, so you might be really interested. I think that one of the major improvements in the next years will be regarding the smart contracts area. Let me remind you that smart contracts don't mean automation. They mean auditable automation. This is a key element because even today, a checkout on Amazon is automation of eventually a commercial relationship, but with smart contracts, you can have that kind of automation with auditability. Still, in our opinion, and to according to a lot of people in the legal tech space and blockchain experts, the journey of smart contracts will take some time. Even in the longer term, there will be a need of dispute resolution systems, and according to our point of view, for having a mass adoption and therefore a possible replacement of paper contracts by smart contracts, there is also a need of a quite more complete Oracle system. The oracles will be the key, in our opinion. An oracle is any element that can introduce on a DLT, on a blockchain, and for the purpose of executing of a smart contract, an external element. Now, this is one area. There is also another area, which is related to the justice sector. I can say even the public one of public courts, and for sure, regarding the dispute resolution by private entities, so any kind of ADR. The key element of transparency of blockchain, in our opinion, will be used in the future for dispute resolution processes. Let me give you just an idea and an example. For example, the appointment of a specific judge or of a specific arbitrator could happen in a few years, or maybe on our system that we are currently developing, thanks to a randomized algorithm. This could enhance, you know, the chance of transparency and therefore eventually to limit, to reduce hypotheses of corruptibility of the system, for example, I mean, in theoretical and practical terms. Also, as we have seen as so far with Luigi, some kind of new ODR systems, which are blockchain-based, could address the problem of micro-sized disputes that currently they do not have any kind of reliable solution as per today. Let me give you an overview of what did happen as so far. What did happen exactly in this new interesting blockchain world on the ADR, let's say justice, not in technical terms, and blockchain. Since 2015, so 1 year after the Ethereum launch, a few projects started to work in the area of ADR. Which was the reason? The reason was that smart contracts, especially at that time and then during the bubble of 2017, were absolutely considered by a lot of people as the future of contracts. At that time, everyone, also some law firms, were writing, look guys, we are going to change completely the way we are going to work. But also at that time was clear that smart contracts can have two huge limits. The first limit is when there is a technical failure. If a smart contract is not reversible, by definition, this could be a big problem. As you know, by your experience, since most of you are lawyers, in your day-to-day, you see, you experience how contracts must be reversed, reimbursements, failure, and so on. The second problem with smart contracts is subjectivity. This is a huge and major problem. The code, the dry code, can't assess subjectivity. If I will do a smart contract or a legal contract, smart legal contract, sorry, with Luca for asking him to provide to me a new logo design, I need a logo for my new activity. Fantastic. How is possible that a smart contract manages this relationship where the beauty of the logo can't be assessed normally by pure code? How can a machine assess if the logo has been made properly? These two were, to be really short, the major problems that already in 2015, 2016, people started to talk about. In a few projects, popped up in the space with different kind of solutions. Some of them are not anymore active projects. Some of them, like Kleros or Aragon or Az, Materium, are in place. Some of them, they pivoted, changed some, including us, partially we expanded our reach. And at that time, as Luigi was mentioning and showing you, there was one kind of main approach. The approach was, to give you a clear idea, trying to transpose from the blockchain and crypto world based more on economic incentives, the approach was to try to transpose that approach in an ODR approach. We call, just for the purpose to giving you a clear concept, this approach like the one which is trying to decentralize the, decentralizing the act of judgment. So as in the example that Luigi was showing you, including us at Jure with the open layer platform, we tried and we are still testing with universities and people to build an ODR system for some really small claims where a group of people like a jury can vote on one side or on the other. And according to the vote they express, they could be rewarded. This approach has been similar to some other projects. And this model, of course, has one core principle. There is no written decision. There is no arbitrator. There is no one single judge, let's say. And therefore, it is not clear, at least in most of these projects, if there can be a typical, you know, right of defense expressed and guaranteed by the chance of the claimant and the respondent to explain their own reasons by written means, for example. And it's not clear if there is, I mean, more advanced explanation and regarding the outcome of the decision and so far and so on. This model can be discussed for really long. So if you want, you can ask me more in the question Q&A session. What I wanted to share with you is that clearly this model can be problematic for the current adoption at least. Why? Legally speaking, and I will, I mean, not mention the other problems, legally speaking, this is hardly for almost every country and legal framework can be considered a real, you know, arbitration or at least something that can be considered, I mean, respecting the typical constitutional requirements for any ODR procedure. Of course, there are also practical problems. These models require critical masses of voters. And as a matter of fact, as per today, there are no that huge number of users of dApps, decentralized applications in the world. At the same time, we do believe that in the future, this will change. We do believe that maybe in 5, 10, 15 years, who knows, these kind of solutions or some variations would bring a huge disruption, especially for micro disputes. That's our idea. That's why we talk about this topic in terms of micro justice as a future emerging trend. As entrepreneurs, as innovators, at the same time, we think that we should adopt strategies that can create these long-term benefits in a sustainable way. We think that the time has arrived for, I mean, also approaches that can build sustainable processes for projects like ours and bring, I mean, a progressive, you know, innovation that start at the same time with solid foundations, which means to currently address a problem, to currently be able to solve in an efficient way, more efficient way, that problem. That's why we, Azure, are finally releasing the second product that we are, we mentioned in our first white paper with the name of Court Layer. And this product solves the function to solve one major problem. I will go really short on this aspect. If you want, you can ask us more. And the idea, of course, is to take acquaintance of the massive problem that today exists for every kind of dispute which is regarding medium or small values, 50K, 100K, 150K. If you see the data of OECD, for every small or medium claim, let's say the disputes regarding normally the small and medium enterprises, almost in every country, they require a lot of money and a lot of time. And this creates a huge problem in terms of loss of GDP for the country and in terms, of course, of efficiency of the economical system. This data is also a bit, you know, we like to put this kind of concept together with another data. Of course, it's just an estimation. 46%, they estimate, of human beings live today under protection of the law. Part of these, of course, regards civil and administrative disputes. Other part of this estimation regards public and criminal law that we do not touch for sure. At the same time, 59% of the people today are estimated to have access to internet. So what we propose and we are finally delivering is a new system. We are delivering a platform, which is a multi-jurisdiction platform, which is 100% digital, and it covers 166 countries, as the institutional model is legally recognized, at least in those 166 countries. The purpose of this platform is to allow the creation of digital arbitration chambers. We call them hubs. The idea is to provide a legally binding procedure in terms of arbitration, which hopefully guarantees the solution of a dispute in 30 days. It's clear that in case of technical consultancy activities required, this timeframe can expand. It might be 60 days, it might be 4 months eventually. The costs of this procedure should be a bit less than the today alternatives. And the reason why stems from the fact that the entire procedure is fully digitalized. We use blockchain in this platform for some key and crucial aspects. For example, the randomized selection of the arbitrator, or some advanced features of quality assessment of the arbitrator, because we do believe that, in our opinion, modern ADR systems should really solve the problem of quality assessment. How can we trust an arbitration panel which is online without knowing which exactly and specifically which is the betting system that it is applied, and which is the ongoing betting system that is applied every time an arbitrator issues a judgment? Our goal with this project is to open in the next months digital arbitration chambers with partners in several countries. In the moment I'm speaking with you, we finalized agreements for at least 7 jurisdictions from day one, and we will do some testing activities during this autumn for providing a 10 times faster dispute resolution experience to the small and medium enterprises of these places. Our partners are also some public institutions. This project is made also for supporting, you know, for alleviating the backlog of public courts that is a problem, of course. And the spirit, the vision we do that is the one of a progressive road to decentralization, which means that as a team, as a company, we do not want to run those hubs. We look for partners that co-invest with us in doing that. And we will be both a technological provider and, let's say, a subject which has as a goal the one to ensure the same standard, the same reliability, the same process. It's like a constitutional, let's say, guarantor of some key principles of this procedure. Of course, it's an arbitration procedure, so the decisions are made legally binding. I would like to stress out that the response we are receiving in these months and weeks are, of course, positive. And I think that this activity is quite useful also, unfortunately, in the light of the problems and the new run for digitalization caused by the COVID. I hope that with my, short speech, I gave to you, first of all, a wider clarification of why blockchain is legal, about smart legal contracts and justice. I wanted to show you and give you just the input if you want to, of course, to expand with your own researchers the experience that in the world have been done in this area from 2015 up to today. I try to explain to you, therefore, a bit more the logic behind the decentralized, let's say, ODR proposals currently, you know, building up in the world. And at the same time, I try to explain to you the solution and the approach that we at Jure are trying to put in place, which is, taking acquaintance of the need of sustainability and progressive, you know, improvements based on solid elements and effective solutions as per today. Thank you for your attention, and I will be delighted to answer to your questions. I'm trying to see if there are Q&A. Okay, it seems they are not. Maybe Luca, we can wrap up some Q&A of.
Yeah, Ale. First, let's leave the word for to Jane. She will take forward her talk, and we can do the Q&A session all together at the end.
Excuse me. I think there's someone have questions to Ali.
Yeah, there is a question from Hing Yu. So arbitrators, are those arbitrators selected by juror? No, this is a key element in our case. Yeah, sure, with pleasure. So if you're interested, we will be really glad to expand this point, but in practical terms, there will be several hubs, eventually one per country in the quite shortest time possible. It is going to be the hub admin, which is like the chairman of a digital arbitration chamber, to do the betting. So as juror, we do not select arbitrators. It will be the responsible of the hub to select those. On day one, the betting procedure will be based on titles, a minimum years of experience in the legal field, and also there will be a referral process. So the standard we are currently discussing with the current hub admins is to, for example, ask to anyone who applies to become an arbitrator, three references, and so that we try to be, I mean, to ensure a platform which is quite serious on that aspect. If you are interested about that, by the way, you're absolutely welcome to stay in touch. Sure. They are paid by the fees of the parties. So the business model is essentially for every dispute that it is assigned to an arbitrator, the arbitrator is paid by the party. So there is a fee sharing between arbitrator, juror, and the hub admin. Most of this fee goes, of course, to the arbitrator when there is one single arbitrator, or to the three arbitrators when the procedure is made with three arbitrators. So normally, according to the studies and all the simulations we did on 10 countries, the fees to be paid is quite interesting for the arbitrator. And at the same time, it is considered as, at least virtually for now, really affordable for the party. So to be really clear, in case someone becomes an arbitrator in the future, comfortably from the platform, they will be as it. There will be a chance that they will be assigned with the dispute resolution of a dispute, and there will be a clear, amount paid. This amount, of course, is paid in fiat money, in case the party, of course, paid in fiat, and it is paid at the end of the procedure. So normally it will be after 30 or 60 days since the procedure started.
Okay, if someone has more, okay, here you go.
If the case, I'm trying to, there are a lot of interesting questions from Ing, so I'm going forward. Thanks, Ing, for this, the interest that you're showing, really, really appreciated. So you are touching, now Ing is asking, what does happen in case of a small amount dispute? How is the economic effectiveness being considered? So the standard we propose to every digital arbitration chamber, but again, the final decision is not on juror, is to, generally speaking, ask as a fee for dispute resolution the 5% of the value of the dispute. So when you ask me this question, we have to analyze the target of disputes that a specific hub wants to, again, targeting. And where the 5% of the dispute is too low, it might be a bit increased. So just to give you an idea, some hubs that we are currently building up will be targeting disputes of at least 30K or 50K of value. So below that threshold, they probably won't be interested in solving the dispute. At the same time, there will be other hubs targeting only really small disputes, and they will try to be even faster in the dispute resolution procedure. Of course, not in the first months, but for disputes below 10K, for example, $10,000, we as a platform and some hub admins will encourage only in that case lawyerless procedures. But why? Because normally it depends on the country, but in most of the countries normally, if you have a dispute of $3,000, as per today, you probably will avoid to go before public courts. Of course, you will avoid to go before arbitration. And as a matter of fact, in some countries, there are no efficient solutions. In some countries, there are in place. So in case like this, for example, 3K disputes, there will be, I mean, most of the fee will go to the arbitrator and it will be higher than 5%. We will encourage in that case to have an arbitrator which is going to also manage the dispute without lawyers. So you will have to do also, I mean, another job, but it's which is the preparation and clarification of the, you know, the claims, talking with a single party. But we expect that to happen not before than Q2 2021. So on the first days, the first apps probably will target 30-50K disputes at least, up to $1 million, and the fee will go, I mean, mostly to the arbitrator. So if you are interested about that, you will please send us an email. We will be absolutely glad to keep you posted. Also, I mean, when you want about the chance to apply to become arbitrator in the upcoming apps. I think we are, oh, hi, Inge. Yeah, great to be in touch, actually. I don't know if we are in the same panel because I'm the deep tech dispute resolution panel of Oxford as well. So happy to be in touch. And let's chat later. Maybe we can we can expand these topics. But I really appreciate all these questions. Super. Okay. Great.
Thank you, Ian, and thank you, Ali. Luca, do you want to add anything? Oh, we just move on.
I think, Jane, we can move on. You can touch maybe briefly, on the legal tech scenario in China, and then we can move with a very quick Q&A session.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry, I will make my speech in Chinese. Okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Let me share my... OK, Hello, 大家好，那个我今天为大家分享的话题是法律科技在中国的发展，就是 Legal Technology in China。那我们今天分享的内容将是按照以下四个部分来进行。首先会给大家做一个简单的概述，就是目前在中国法律科技发展的一个基本情况，然后会为大家第二部分会为大家分析一下那个电子签名相关的一些法律影响，第三个呢，我也会在就是为大家一起共同讨论一下那个智能合约 smart contract， 从法律的角度怎么样来理解，然后第四个部分那个我们也会与大家分享一下。区块链与争议解决或者我们叫那个 ODR 的一个关系，然后一个在中国的一个应用。那首先我们说法律科技的一个发展，那个在不久的以前那个法律对科技的关注可能还仅仅是聚焦于我们如何利用法律手段为新技术发展的企业或者是新技术发展的应用带来的一个挑战，保驾护航，或者是为他们的融资提供服务， 为他们的监管进行，为他们的一个政策提供一些监管措施。那个但是随着新技术的不断发展，逐渐的渗透到各行各业，其实法律与科技的结合已经成为显著发展趋势。所以科技为法律的发展和进化也开辟了新的天地。那我们说法律科技是一个什么概念呢？我们可以把它看成为就是说一个可以提高法律服务或者是法律服务的效率或者是体验的一个科技的平台或者是一个科技的服务系统。那我们前面也开场的时候也提到了那个 ABCD， 就是 AI、 Blockchain、 Cloud、 Big Data， 这些新技术、新应用、新业态的发展都使得法律科技的边界实际上是不断的拓展，而且也不断的夯实了这个法律科技产品的一些细节。那那个所以技术革命也给法律带来了一场自动化、数字化、智能化的变革。刚才前面几位嘉宾也为我们分享了在那个在欧洲包括全球的有一些进展。所以我们说法律和科技结合已经融合更加深入了，实际上是一个互相影响共同发展、彼此成就的一个过程。那我们说目前我们说那个目前法律的活动那个在中国的情况呢，其实也是有非常蓬勃的一个发展的状况。那我们这里面列了几个典型的相关的公司。那这个我们知道这个易签宝和法大大它是提供电子合同的相关服务的，包括电子签名还有电子合同的模板啊、电子证据的存证啊相关的服务。那那个李麦和法狗狗呢，它是致力于通过 AI 与法律的结合，通过大数据 AI 来进行一些个法律的检索呀，还有整理资料，还有提供一个简单的咨询，通过大数据的分析大数据通过大数据分析采信率呀，还有那个案件的结案结果来做出一个更好的判断。那这是这是跟那个我们说签名啊还有法律服务相关的。那这个 DeFOS 是什么呢？ DeFOS 它其实是一个那个开放式的金融协议堆栈。怎么说呢？就是说DeFOS 它是一个已经在区块链上的一堆智能合约。那它实际上主要是用在金融方面，所以它实际上我们说叫开放式金融，就是decentralized finance， 就是那个去中心化的金融。那主要是在这方面的一个使用。我们为什么要在这里提它呢？就是实际上实际上这个 decentralized 的这个finance 发展也很快，然后他们有很多的合约是值得我们也要进，就是法律人士也要进行一个研究的。那其实从这些方面来看呢，我们看法律科技的发展大概是就是有这样的三个阶段。那第一个阶段呢，就是是一个法律信息或者我们说是一个法律信息和诉讼流程的这样一个数字化和在线化的一个发展。比如说我们中国的那个互联网法院，那实际上我们现在已经成立了三个互联网法院，就是杭州互联网法院还有北京互联网法院，还有广州互联网法院。那这个是一个主要是在信息和流程方面的数字化和在线化。然后第二个发展阶段呢，就是我们实际上就是法律服务的一个智能化和自动化。其实这里面呢，就是主要就我们运用到了 AI 和那个大数据的一个技术。那个所以通过 AI 和大数据的发展，我们现在基本上也可以在一定程度上是可以实现比如说合同或者判决书的法律文件的自动生成或者是 案件结果的预测，或者甚至是甚至是合同的审查，智能化法律咨询，可以精准的，其实我们现在就是在某种程度上是已经可以做到一个精准提供一个精准的法律服务了。就像我们中伦，其实我们今年也出了一个通过大数据的分析，分析那个上市公司同业竞争的一个报告，也是运用了这个法律技术。那这个也是我们，这是我们说的第二个阶段，可能是法律活动的一个智能化自动化的这样的一个过程。那再发展到第三个阶段，其实就是我们刚才提到的那个法律代码化的，就是 code。 我们一直说 code is the law， 就是这个代码它开始承担一定的法律功能。所以这也是我们为什么要提那个 DeFos， 等一下我们在后面可能还会再讲讲这个德非相关的一些事情。那这个代码现在就是代码可能已经不仅仅是用来执行一个法律的规则，其实它也是会用来创造一个法律的规则，或者是来解释一个法律的规则。所以那个就是进一步的发展可能尤其是 blockchain 使得这个更加有了可能性。那我们可能更加要关注这方面的情况，尤其是现在新的发展趋势就是更加多元化，我们法律科技是发展更加多元化，而且法治化全球化的情况。那这个是我们的那个法律科技在中国的发展现状。那个我们可以看到，其实我们国家的法律科技在2012年的时候，我们基本上是没有专利，到2013年也没有什么发展。这个时候实际上是2013年那个比特币出来，就是 blockchain 开始被大家逐渐的认识。然后到2016年，我们全球有579个专利，我们也有将近200个专利了。到2018年，我们就迅速已经上升到就是全球变成933个专利的时候，我们已经上升到475个专利了。我们可以看到，就是说很多的技术的团队也开始关注这个法律这个领域。所以可能在法律科技的方面也开始逐渐增加了那个专利的申请数量。那我们说这个专利申请数量也是一定程度上可以作为一个我们判断这个技术发展的情况的一个标签吧。那我们说那个我们一直说这个新技术那新技术跟我们法律比较紧密相关的部分，其实就是我们一直提到的ABCD 都是相关的。那那个说人工智能呢，就是因为其实人工智能的应用已经有很多公司可以通过人工智能来进行律师的选择，包括进行一些案例的梳理，甚至案例的梳理推荐律师，或者是那个或者是通过人工智能来分析来进行一个就是法规的搜索。那通过大数据呢，我们知道就是有些大数据的应用使得就比如说有一些案件经过大数据的分析以后，对于案件的审判的一个结果的推测实际上都是可以实现的。那个所以我们看到新技术对法律的行业其实提出了很大的挑战。那个我们说 blockchain 这个就是更加是因为 blockchain， 刚才那个前面几位嘉宾也分享了，就是尤其是阿里提到了 decentralization， 就是那个去中心化的这样一个概念。那可能通过 blockchain 就是可以实现这样的一个可能性。那个这个也对律师行或者对法律行业也是一个巨大的挑战，因为其实律师行业还是有一点中心化的意思的。那还有就是我们提到，其实电子签名呢也是一个也随着科技的发展也是有了一些变化。所以包括我们刚才提到的前面的易租宝啊，就是易签宝啊，法大大，就是这些电子签名公司，其实他们的技术也在从最早的 那个啊，只是互联网上，那个互联网上的一个签名，发展到那个利用 blockchain 或者是利用其他更先进的技术，那个啊来进行电子签名的一个操作。那个那我们说，这些新技术和我们的法律之间的关系，那我们是有一个原则。那我们这个原则呢，就是技术中立的原则，就是 technology neutral。这个原则呢，是什么意思呢？就是说我们对新技术的应用，是采用技术中立原则的。那个啊，我们不会因为新技术的采用而影响法律效力。就是我们的法律一般是规定的是一个事件，那个啊，并不会因为你使用不同的工具而使得这个事件的结果产生不同的认识。所以这个话题就是这样一个原则怎么样适用呢？等一下我们讲到智能合约的时候再给大家做一个仔细的分析。那我们说那个这是一个技术中立的原则。那我们在那个司法实践中，那个当然就是要进行积极的探索，包括司法机关和法律行业都应该积极的参与到这个新科技在法律实务中的应用。就像我们刚才也已经跟大家分享了，其实在那个在中国目前的现状，尤其是那个就是这个病毒发生期间，其实那个互联网法院也起了很大的作用。所以我们现在实际上就是在线的那个在线的法律的救济方式，其实已经在中国已经得到了一定的应用吧。那接下来我们先为大家分享一下电子签名的电子签名的一些相关法律问题。首先我们说这个电子签名是那个是有一个中华人民共和国电子签名法。那我们这个法律实际上在2004年就已经首次发布了，所以这个电子签名本身并不是一个新鲜的东西，只是说在2004年的时候可能技术手段是不一样的。所以那个电子签名法在2015年做过一次修订，然后2019年去年又做过一次第二次修订。那这是现在我们看到的最新的是那个19年4月23日发布实施的。那我们看到这里面就是提到了，就是电子签名它对电子签名是有一个定义的，就是用数据电文以电子形式所含所赋予识别签名人身份表明签名人认可其中内容的一个数据。其实它还是一个数据，就是我们这个是那个相当于是一个如果是我们是智能合约或者是我们一个传统世界纸质文件传到那个线上以后，有这样一个通过这样的一个数据来确认这个文件形式的一个就是等于是一个工具。那个那我们说这个电子签名可以适用于什么样的合同？那大家可以看到，它是适用于商业合同是没有问题，但是适用于跟人身有关系的合同，那就是不可以适用的，这是中国的法律规定的。然后当然也对于那个公用事业服务的一部分也是禁止适用那个电子签名的。那我们就看一下那个可靠的电子签名的一个生效要件，那是怎么样规定的。首先是要能够识别是电子签名人的专有。那个这个我们的电子签名的那个服务商，就我们刚才提到的易签宝什么，他们都是可以做到，就是要电子签名人专有，然后要由电子签名人控制，他可以自由使用的，那个也不会被别人拿来使用。签署后对电子签名的任何改动是要能够被发现的，这个也是很重要。这也是为什么blockchain 这个区块链这个技术被使用以后，其实那个是很受欢迎。那个就是很多电子签名的系统也是利用了 blockchain 的这样一个特征，它这不易篡改的这样的一个特征。所以那个 这个也是电子签名的一个很重要的生效要件，就是当然还有那个第四个就是说签署后对电子文件内容的改动也要能够被发现。那这个目前的那个电子签名技术提供商应该基本上都是没实现这样的功能都是没有问题。那个他们都提供了，其实很多平台都可以提供多样化的电子签名服务，也可以提供一些相关的，甚至是印模呀，或者是那个反正保护客户隐私的一些服务。在这方面其实中国的发展是已经是蛮先进的了。那个接下来呢是跟大家分享一下关于智能合约的我们的一些思考。那首先刚才Rafael 和那个艾莉都讲了智能合约的问题。那我们说智能合约的一个基本原理，那个就是刚才那个 Rafael 也先生也提到了，说是智能合约是一串计算机的代码。那个那我们也认为确实它是一个是一串计算机的代码。那个那实际上就是我们原来的传统的合同条款，就是我们也知道我们大家都做律师啊法律工作者，我们知道我们很多合同其实也是一环套一环的，也是如果什么条件怎么样，然后应该怎么样那个执行，也是很多是这样的逻辑性的那个安排。所以说那个也可以通过一个计算机代码来实现。那这是我们说智能合约主要是它是一个实现这样一个操作的一个一串计算机代码，然后要部署在区块链上。那个当然就是部署在区块链上以后，因为利用区块链不可篡改的这个特性，同时经过各方签署，就是我们刚才说，因为现在电子签名在各个国家就是不同的 jurisdiction 可能就是不同的法域对它的法律规定可能不一样，但是基本上都是承认这个电子签名的效力的。所以那个我们国家也是承认，就刚才我们讲到的，所以它经过各方签署以后呢，可以在区块链上自动运行。这个就是这是还有智能合约还有一个很重要特点，就是它要预设条件，就是就是在条件成立的时候这个合同会生效，然后会自动运行。就我们下面说它会自动执行，这个自动执行呢，因为是部署在区块链上，所以它是一个必然的不可逆的这样的一个情况。所以区块链代码一旦编写完成上链以后，智能合约就会不可逆的自动运行，而不考虑现实情况的变化。那这就是技术的人提出来 code is the law， 就是他们写好 code 以后这就已经是规则了，你只能按照规则进行。这是为什么我们看到很多德非，就是刚才我们提到的那个就是我们刚才提到 decentralized finance， 他们一系列的那个合同金融合同的金融合同的制备，就是作为以智能合约的形式出现的。那我们说从我们法律人的角度来看，智能合约和我们说的合同合同法下的合同是什么关系呢？那我们认为呢，首先合同法下的合同对合同的记载形式是没有特，就是那如果是书面形式和或者是口头形式，在形式上没有特别约定说不可以通过计算机代码的这个电子的这个数据来实现。所以这我们认为这个是我们的计算机代码实际上是合同记载的一种形式。那个我们计算机这个智能合约的一个很重要特点是它在条件预设成功的时候是可以自动执行，所以它是提供了一个比较特别的执行方式的安排。那怎么样我们来认定这个智能合约它是不是一个合同关系成立呢？这个是要根据各个国家的法律，就大部分法律的那个法律都是认为，如果这个智能合约的所有的条件 都满足当地合同法对合同要件的一些规定，那我们就可以把这个智能合约视为一个合同关系，合同关系成立。那这个合同关系是不是成立，对我们法律的人士来说是非常重要的，因为只有合同关系成立了，我们接下来执行如果出现了问题去进行争议解决，进行仲裁，这个才有一个基础。但是接下来我们就带来的问题就是说那如果smart contract 有 bugs 那怎么办呢？那个就像我们其实前一阵子德飞出现了很多问题，那个就是被黑客攻击，然后使得那个使得客户和平台都遭受了巨额的损失。那在这种情况下，我们这个法律救济是应该怎么样来是应该采用什么样的法律手段来对这样的情况进行救济呢？这个实际上是也是我们应该就是思考的问题。那个最近我们也是写了一篇这方面的文章。那我们认为可能可以有从两个角度来谈这个救济的问题。首先是说民事救济，那我们可以建议是不是可以约定管辖。我们知道那个在 smart contract 制备在那个区块链上以后，它是一个在网上的一个情况，所以很难确定使用人的那个在什么地方，所以在这个管辖权的那个在管辖权的确定问题上其实是提出了挑战的。所以我们建议是不是或者是在智能合约里，或者是通过某一个手段可以大家形成一个对管辖权的一个约定，那个就是我们提出一些思考供大家一起来探讨。然后那个第二个呢，我们建议说是不是可以对增加责任方的责任。那因为因为虽然是由于黑客的攻击导致了那个导致 smart contract 执行导致 smart contract 造成客户的重大损失。但是项目方因为作为他提供 smart contract 这个项目方，那个你对这个就是这个技术的这个合约是不是有一个责任？那比如说我们其实我们知道现在对这个技术的这个 smart contract 也是有一个那个代码审计的这样的一个活动，但是代码审计公司和项目方之间实际上有一定的利益冲突。代码审计公司提出的建议项目方是不是会采纳，如果没有采纳由此造成的法律后果，由此如果导致了客户的损失造成的法律后果是不是可以寻求救济。所以这些法律问题其实都是空白，所以都是需要那个我们法律人士来研究这个相关的问题的。那当然我们也提出就是如果是黑客当然应该承担侵权责任，但是那我们要能找到黑客才行。那个我们知道在那个区块链上那个就是区块链的匿名性的特点可能也会使得寻找到这个黑客是非常困难的。那另外一个那个如果是跳出我们这个智能合约的这个角度，我们说这样的一个商业模式上面，我们是不是可以通过购买一种商业保险的方式来实现那个就是 smart contract 的一个救济。那这是我们想到的可以提出来的一些思考的方法，思考的方向。那对于监管机关的那个怎么样来监管这个 smart contract 的执行，就是其实现在这样的事情实际上已经在发生了。那个我们说首先你这个德飞就是作为如果是一个金融做金融提供金融业务提供金融的那个smart contract 的一个执行一个服务，那我们认为是不是应该有一个监管牌照监管，就是要有申请一个 license。当然那个项目方和那个和用户可能都有责任要配合警方的追查。另外我们认为是不是因为我们这个 smart contract 是制备在项目方的那个区块链上，同时由项目方来负责发布，而且项目方在这个对这个代码它是有更深刻的认识，那个用户可能是没有概念的，因为用户并不是一个技术的人，也不会去研究那个就是这个 contract 到底是怎么写的，到底有没有问题。那所以在这种情况下，我们说是不是可以考虑举证责任倒置，这个burden of proof 是不是应该是加在那个项目方的身上。这是我们对这个智能合约法律漏洞的一些法律救济的一个思考。那个接下来呢，我们就是谈一下那个区块链存证和争议解决的问题。那我们说区块链存证的应用目前在国内实际上还蛮多的，就是法院啊、仲裁庭啊，其实也都积极的参与了这个这方面的安排，就是那个就是区块链存证就是利用了区块链不可篡改的这样一个特性，所以它是非常有利的那个一个取证的非常有利的一个技术，使得取证是非常便捷。那我们知道其实除了刚才我们提到的那个那三个互联网法院，就是杭州互联网法院、北京互联网法院和广州互联网法院，其实广州仲裁委也推出了一个那个仲裁的联盟链，那个它也是可以在线上做这样一个仲裁的安排，那个是可以进行区块链的存证的。那我们说区块链的存证的一些技术特点呢，那个一般呢它都是采用联盟链，就是它会有一些链接法院啊、仲裁机构啊、或者公证机构啊、司法鉴定机构呀。我看到也有一些人提出来，就是那个区块链存证的跟法院的这个链上面应该也有一些律师事务所来参与那个作为联盟链的节点。那个这方面其实也是可以寻求参与的。那这个地方呢，我要提一下，就是和我们阿里刚才帮我们介绍的JIR 的情况是不一样的。就是 JIR 是一个 decentralized justice， 就是我们可以看到它是一个去中心化的一个链，实际上就是我们说是一个公链。那和我们这里的链呢，我们是一个联盟链，就是有一些节点来一起参与的，还是比较中心化的。那这也是一个中国的特色。我们说这是联盟链，然后第二点当然是不可篡改，就是这是区块链的一个很重要的特征。还有就是一个加密算法，通过加密算法以后加密之后也不会泄密，也是可以保护隐私的，这也是一个很重要的区块链的特征。当然可以实现分布式存储。那这个是就是整个存证技术是利用了区块链的一些重要的特点来进行一个来进行这样的一个安排。所以我们可以看到基本上区块链的它的本身的一个特点，使得从证据方面，从尤其是存证方面，实际上是非常有利的。那我们说电子证据的范围，我们刚才提到了说要进行存证呢，就是要涉及到哪些是属于电子证据是可以存证的。这个我们是有民事诉讼法有专门的明确规定的，就是我们前面这里面提到的这些内容，就是网页博客啊，这个我就不为大家仔细念了，就是大家是可以看得到。主要也是一些电子信息。然后我们说电子证据的生效要件，这个就是说实际上就是怎样证明这个电子证据的真实性。那我们说其实刚才也看到了这个部分来看到电子证据并不必然是存在区块链上的。所以我们刚才说区块链存证是你如果存在区块链上，那可以有这样那样有这些特点，但是如果但不是必然存在区块链上，所以电子证据本身在那个法律规定里它是有一定的生效要件的，这是在我们那个民事诉讼法若干规定里面是有一个生效要件的，就是你怎样证明它的真实性。那个一个是你这个提供电子证据的这个平台是要有一个系统也要可靠性，然后运行状态正常、数据完整性、主体适当性等等，还有鉴定和勘验要有这样一些因素保证它你这个真实性。那当然验证的手段，我们说这也是明确规定，我们这边有一个有 那个法律是明确指出了一个是存证平台、可信时间戳、哈希值校验，还有就是区块链。所以如果是存在区块链上，法律是明确认可电子存证的效力的、真实性的效力的。啊，这个我就不为大家解释，因为刚才阿里已经为我们那个详细的讲述了这个 JIR 的一个具体的情况。那个那我那个我为大家分享的内容就到这里。那个接下来大家有什么问题我们可以一起来探讨。那个包括大家如果对其他的那个演讲者有问题也可以一起提出来，我们来十分钟的一个那个一个 Q&A。Hello,
Jane, thank you very much for your presentation. Before moving to the Q&A session, I just wanted to say one thing to all the attendees, and is that we have a WeChat group with JIR, and that we will be sharing all our presentation and slides in the WeChat group. So I just wanted to share with the audience the QR code, so they can easily scan it and join the conversation in the WeChat group. Okay, now it's time for the Q&A final session. So please, all the team come on stage, and also Jane. And Luca, do you want to lead this session?
Sure, with pleasure. Before starting, just a message from JIR as a whole team. As you know, we work on VeChain blockchain, which is a Chinese company. So for us, it's really a pleasure. And thank you so much, Jane, for organizing and hosting the webinar with us. It's really an immense pleasure to be in touch with the Chinese community. This was the first one of this kind of activities that we want to try to do together. So thanks for that. I think we can indeed say that today has been successful. It shows also from the questions, and now we'll be doing this Q&A. So without further ado, I'll just take it forward one question that Raymond Zhu asked before, because it was really an interesting one. And I think it's good if we spend a bit more time on that. So Raymond asked, the smart contract can be very useful in terms of execution upon conditions that are met. So automatic execution, certainty, mass application, and so on. However, variation of smart contract can be difficult because, as we've been talking throughout this session, we always use the concept of immutable contracts, right? So we use that concept to explain smart contracts. So Raymond is asking, in practice, we lawyers will always encounter contracts assigned, terminated, amended, and so on and so forth. So how smart contracts could accommodate the changes where needed? That's a great question, Raymond. And it's a problem that smart contracts indeed have, because once you create a smart contract and you activate it, then that's the software, that's the contract, okay? There is no turnaround or looking back. But there are a couple of points that we need to address in that sense. One is that smart contracts are immutable, but they can memorize data, they can store data. For example, the status of the contract, if the contract has been ongoing, if it's terminated for any reason, and so on and so forth. This type of data, of course, changes in the contract. So the smart contract itself, being immutable, its data can change, okay, according to, of course, the specification of the contract. So the smart contract is a software, it has some functions. According to those functions, the data can change. It can't change for any other function than the ones that are in the contract. Okay, that's first point. The second point is that the developers community, the tech community, it's working on creating upgradable smart contracts in such a way that if you create one smart contract today, for example, for a lease agreement for one of your clients or something like that, or a real estate purchase, potentially we can deploy, so the contract goes live, the smart contract goes live, but say that you need to add another clause to it or another behavior, or you need to amend an existing behavior. We are currently, as an overall developers community globally, we are studying solutions to bring that smart contract into a new smart contract. So there will be a link between the previous version and the new version, so that you know that the new version has originated from the previous one, okay? And that's very important because we need a chain between the old smart contract and the new one. Otherwise, you'll be losing all the data that is stored on the previous smart contract. So it's very important that we address that issue, right? Because otherwise you'll be losing data and the transactions that were related to the previous contract. I hope this answers the question, Raymond. It's an open topic and still under works. And I'll also address quickly the one regarding cryptocurrencies. Yes, these ODR systems, of course, they do need to support as many options as possible, because that's how you create adoption, right? If your client, think of your law firm, right? If your client wants to pay in USD rather than Chinese yuan, you need to be flexible, because it's their will, their decision in the end. So you need to provide them as many options. Do need to do the same. In JUR, we started from the JUR token. So that's, of course, a choice that we had to make because we can't start from day one with everything. But gradually, we want to support more crypto assets. And for the solutions that we are, the new product that Alessandro has briefly mentioned regarding the legally binding multi-jurisdiction open justice platform, that platform will support also fiat currency payments. So you as a and then there will be a translation, an exchange rate happening basically under the hood without the client being, you know, it doesn't need to be aware and worry about holding tokens and so on and so forth. So that's like a transparent mechanism that we have, we are building right now. Okay, I would ask to Jane, Luigi, and Alessandro to, you can unlock your video so that everyone can see you. And we'll be starting a very quick session in though, because we have been so long, there were questions in the middle. So we don't want to, take this too long, but I'll start with a very generic question for you, Jane, because we know that legal tech industry in China is in its infancy. It's, it's not like a mainstream movement. But for those that are here today, those are really like an elite, an exception to the rule. Lawyers that are interested on what's happening on the technology side. I would like to ask you your point of view on this. Like, how do you think, you know, legal technology and especially blockchain technology can, you know, move forward in China? And for those colleagues of yours that, for example, today are present in the webinar, other lawyers, Chinese lawyers, how can they keep up with the latest developments, latest improvement? Is there really a need for them to be updated constantly about what's happening on the technology field? Or can they just, ignore what's happening, maybe outsource it to someone else and then get the information from them? What are your thoughts on that?
Of course, in my opinion, it's very important to follow, very important and necessary to follow the trends of the development of legal tech, right? Because I do. And I think sometimes I worry, like, if AI will take over some legal work, and if like big data will, also do a lot of work, then lawyer may, have to change your work behavior. So sometimes I think about it. Also with the blockchain, especially, now in China, actually we have, like I mentioned in my speech, we have online codes. We have three online codes now, and also one local arbitration, online arbitration blockchain as well. So it's developing very fast. It's not like, you know, something new actually. And it most of them are also, supported by some famous legal tech companies. So it's also booming in China, but maybe for lawyers, lawyers have different point of view on the technology. For the technology guys, engineering, they like to like do fintech, legal tech, you know, every tech. But for lawyers, maybe they don't, like lawyers don't know very well about technology, so not too care about it. But now I know many young lawyers are key to know more and, you know, want to join the trend. Also for the blockchain, it's mainly it's I think the essence of blockchain is decentralization, but it cannot, you know, make it happen in China now. So we will see. And also, if people are interested in the legal tech, legal tech trend, you can actually learn. You can get information, collect the information from some official WeChat official account, like Tang Sen Lu Tou, Fa Lu Quan, and some Westlaw database official accounts, and also legal miner, those kind of, you know, legal. Those kind of WeChat official account can provide many informations. Okay, thank you, Luca.
Thank you so much, Jane. I hope that those interested have taken note. I'll ask a question to Alessandro, and maybe also Luigi and you can give your comments regarding we have talked about ODR, online justice, online system, and a jurisdiction like China that has moved, as you mentioned, Jane, already ahead when it comes to online proceeding. I wanted to ask to Alessandro, given that most instead of the rest of the world is lacking this kind of solutions, do you think a platform like the Open Justice of Jure can be helpful in some way in China as well? Or do you see like a potential, collaboration that Jure could do with the local authority in which, we can provide more efficiency or a better platform or something like that? What do you feel regarding this?
So thanks, Luca, for the question. I would say that, in general terms, China seems really advanced in terms of technology, also usage in the legal field and specifically in the dispute resolution field. So that said, I would say that, probably it would be interesting to understand how the, the smaller sides of claims are managed. So maybe in that niche for that aspect, that could be a point of, intersection between two areas that could be eventually mutually, satisfactory. At the same time, of course, there is a thing which we are aware of that, compared to other jurisdictions, the Chinese one require, the dispute resolution is not available for any private individuals. There must be a different, setup. So that's why probably, yes, cooperating with some already existing entity would be absolutely great.
Thanks, Ale. Luigi, any thoughts on this? Maybe on the, generally these online solution, tech solutions are the speed of adoption from, courts. I mean, we've seen this in other jurisdictions. Of course, we are not that familiar with China, but, the speed of adoption of this solution is quite slow generally. What are your thoughts on that? How we can improve How can lawyers, for example, give their contribution to, you know, maybe bring awareness of these new possibilities?
Okay, I believe that for sure, as Alessandro said, collaboration with authorities are important, but also the way lawyers can push for the adoption is way too important, because as a lawyer, once you realize, let's say, that you can start an arbitration by just staying before your monitor, by just filing an online request without traveling and so on and so forth, you are providing the same product to your clients, like the same, let's say, consultancy product to your clients, but you reduce cost, you reduce time. And so even if maybe at the end of the day, you end up asking for a lower payment to your customers, but it becomes easier for you to manage more requests for arbitration, you know? And so for lawyers, this could be extremely useful, but at the end of the day, if you think of users, end users, I mean, it's also useful for them, because if I'm the manager, okay, of a small, medium enterprise, and I'm struggling to evolve my own business, I want to dedicate most of my time for expanding my business, not for dealing with disputes. And so I would prefer to avoid traveling or being involved in complex procedures with many frictions. So I believe that this kind of platform also in China could be useful for reducing frictions. That's how you improve adoption, by eliminating frictions, by showing that this is just easier way for handling things, and the most convenient ones, also from a financial standpoint.
Makes sense. What are your thoughts, Jane, on this aspect?
I think it actually depends. Probably, especially for international cases, it's not lawyers say, but for local cases, like I mentioned, we already have some online courts and also online arbitration blockchain thing, and I'm sure there are more will come. So later people may get used to it, will like to use it.
Yeah, I think as well that cross-border transactions, international transactions, could be a good use case for this type of solution. And that makes a lot of sense. Okay, I think we have gone way beyond our time today, because it was a lovely chat. Again, for anyone who's interested, please do join our WeChat group. There are some legal tech discussions ongoing there. I would thank you, Jane, again, for the support and hosting this session. Looking forward to future ones in which maybe we can do more vertical and specific topics. Of course, we'll ask our participants to give their feedback and tell us, you know, what they want to explore more. We are definitely open to that. Jane, I leave it to you for the wrap up, for saying bye to everyone. Maybe you can teach us how to say bye in Chinese so that we can also join you.
Okay, then if anyone has, 如果大家还有什么其他的问题，也可以跟嘉宾留的 email 和我们这个加入我们这个 JR 的这个啊社区粉丝群，那个啊，那谢谢大家利用宝贵的时间来参与我们这个webinar。Okay, then let's see together. 再见。Can you say
that again? Sorry.
再见。
再见。
Yes, very good. Okay.
再见 ，everyone.
Okay, 谢谢大家。
Thank you.
再见。
Okay. Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye bye.